McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Communication Essentials, the tools you need to master every type of professional interaction, by Trey Guinn, narrated by Derek Dysart. Publisher's note: this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. All assessments referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Preface. No matter how broadly my professional network expands, what I observe about humans and how we can enhance our communication effectiveness remains mostly constant. From the first-generation college student in a speech course to the university president rehearsing a commencement address. From the NBA student preparing for interviews to the senior product manager prepping for a difficult conversation. And from the physician who is developing a bedside manner to the CEO prepping for the next earnings call. The faces change, the situations are unique, but important for each of us is understanding and learning to master the communication essentials. If you are looking for a list of fast facts, search the internet and you will find many sources wrapped in clickbait waiting for you. But be forewarned. Mastering communication doesn't work like that. Instead, communication is kind of like running. You can't read a web page on running and then win the Boston Marathon. You have to dig deep and do the work. Fortunately, the work can be fun. If you're looking for an engaging book that's designed to support you on the pathway toward enhancing your communication effectiveness, you've come to the right place. This book has been written for you, no matter your age, location, or vocation. In Part 1, The Essentials, I invite you to explore essential elements of communication and to be introspective with yourself as a communicator. In Part 2, The Essentials Applied, I provide an easy-to-remember framework for how to apply and eventually master the communication essentials. In Part 3, Beyond the Essentials, I give pro tips for navigating a variety of professional communication scenarios. Let's get started. Part 1, The Essentials. Chapter 1, Be a Communication Student for Life. I'm writing this chapter early on a Tuesday morning. A fact I first learned when the friendly hotel staff gave me a courtesy wake-up call. After placing an order for some coffee and fruit, I do some journaling on my iPad. Next, I listen to my audiobook while knocking out some emails and other urgent messages, followed by FaceTiming with my family to wish my kids an enjoyable day at school. Next up, I'm meeting a friend who lives in town for a morning jog and quick bite at his favorite breakfast spot. Then it's a 90-minute presentation to a group of people I have yet to meet, followed by lunch with the event coordinator and a series of Ubers and plane rides to get me home. For now, it's only 6 a.m. Pacific time and I'm still alone in my hotel room, yet communication has and will continue to fulfill my day. Your day may look similar or quite different from mine. However, I am certain that one thing is the same. We both communicate a lot more than we even realize. Some of us have the awareness that we can and should always be improving ourselves as communicators. Whether formally, informally, or without even knowing, we are all students of communication. This is not merely because we receive many inputs of information each day communicated to us in myriad ways. But also, like a snowball rolling downhill, each of us can take our everyday experiences as means for increasing our understanding and abilities as communicative beings. As a dedicated student of human communication, I strive to do my best at making good sense of the subject, stewarding the discipline, and passing the torch well. Hence, this is not the first book on communication, and it will not be the last. As long as there are communicators who communicate, there will always be more to say about communication. This is partly because of humans' enduring fascination with and connection to the subject matter. Specific topics and titles span from how to find the right words to inspire your team to knowing what to do when there are too many ways to communicate at work. The last three articles I read on communication taught me 7 tips for how to nail a hybrid presentation, the delicate art and science of savvy self-promotion, and 3 strategies for how to ask for help at work without alienating your coworkers. This content wouldn't be produced for a non-existent audience, so it's clear there's a real craving for insights that can help us thrive at work and beyond. Though each of us has communicated our entire lives, we are all aware that we can do it better. We have varying ways of discovering and sharing communication knowledge, skills, and abilities. This book is one such effort. So is coaching a child to be attentive, listen actively, and demonstrate respect when interacting with teachers. So is recommending that a friend wear a blazer and smile more during an interview. Each of us plays a part in the communication learning journey, and the learning should never stop. That is partly because as much as we evolve as a species, so too do the ways in which we communicate. When I arrived at college in fall 2000, our residence hall had a landline at the front desk that students would use to call home, request a meeting with their professor, or make plans with someone from across campus. Few people owned a mobile phone. Faculty and students were still making sense of this new thing called email, and some were a bit wary of using it. Fast forward 20 years and my elementary-aged daughter FaceTimed me while writing to ask for my password to download some interactive iPad game that all her friends have. Indeed, communication has been and continues to evolve at lightning speed. And rather than assume innovative technology diminishes old ways of thinking, I find that a return to the fundamentals is necessary for making sense of communication in our modern world. In fact, I find that the communication theories I studied as a doctoral student have become all the more fascinating and informative as the days pass, situations change, and technology disrupts. For this reason, a return to the essentials is, well, essential. Every chef has essential tools and spices. Every artist knows that new colors come from a sophisticated understanding and effective use of primary colors. Likewise, savvy communicators understand that no matter how much things change, you must remain grounded in the communication essentials. This point is one I regularly consider when being contacted for corporate speaking engagements. The requests for communication experts are ever-changing. The top-of-mind issues change, but the foundations of communication don't. As a recent case in point, in 2020 and 2021, nearly every request I received involved some angle of diversity, equity, inclusion, or DEI, and all of them required virtual delivery. Prior to that, the most frequent request was for in-person workshops on topics such as how to communicate like a leader or how to communicate executive presence. What is certain is that any change in the environment or evolution in technology will change the nature of the invitation I receive. For example, we really need someone who can help our people figure out how to present effectively using Zoom, Microsoft Teams, or whatever comes next. There are countless examples of how an organization may frame its need for an expert to come teach on communicating given the jargon of the day or en vogue technology. But no matter the jargon or technology, a large amount of what we must learn stays the same. We have goals as communicators, and we need some help figuring out how to best achieve them. Whether it's Abraham Lincoln delivering the Gettysburg Address or the guy next to me on the plane snapping a picture of his coffee to tweet about how bad it tastes, human communication is about people sending and receiving messages to convey meaning and accomplish goals. Now, trust me, a few scholars in a room could debate ad nauseam over the particulars of the previous sentence, but the general idea will remain. In fact, it can be summed up even tighter. Communication is about messages and meaning. The role of visuals in communication. The power of visuals in the meaning-making of messages can't be underscored enough. Some visual messages are static, while others are dynamic. A stop sign is red and octagon-shaped, and its meaning is indisputable. When you see a stop sign, you must stop. But other symbols are more dynamic, and the associated message may take on a different meaning in a given context. An irate driver extending a middle finger to oncoming traffic is a message with a very different meaning from a college student playfully giving the finger when his best friend beats him at a game of pool. Visuals also help to emphasize a verbal message. The words, "Oh, I just love you," take on a completely different meaning when accompanied by a rolling of the eyes and a sarcastic smirk versus a sincere smile and happy cry. Indeed, there are many nuances and even challenges when constructing the meaning of verbal messages. Without the benefit of context clues or nonverbal behaviors to make the point, we are left to interpret verbal messages as we best understand them. Relying on the words alone can be problematic because much of what we learn about people's thoughts and feelings comes by observing their body language, including watching facial expressions and eye contact. Cultural and relational communication. Communication is also cultural and relational. In some families, hugs, kisses, or similar signs of affection are never exchanged. But in others, every hello, goodbye, good morning, or good night is reinforced with warm hugs, big smiles, and kisses. The communication norms, to hug or not to hug, within any given family or group can serve to express and perhaps reinforce the actual relationships. When we accommodate our communication style to align with the cultural and relational norms of others, we may be signaling respect and even desire to be part of that group. When we do not accommodate our communication style to the majority group, we may be sending the message that we do not understand or perhaps respect the group. If you are a hugger and enter a home insisting on hugging each member of a non-hugging family, it is possible they all will oblige and assume you mean well. Conversely, if you are a non-hugger and enter a home and refuse hugs from each member of a hugging family, they may assume that you think yourself better than them and wish to not be associated with any of them. Imagine if we switch the example to be about whether people engage in a professional handshake when meeting for the first time. Picture yourself with this in mind as you arrive for a job interview. What would it signal to you if you extended your hand to a hiring manager who clearly noticed yet refused your gesture to shake hands? Or how would you feel if your potential hiring manager greeted you at the interview with an extended hug and kiss on the cheek? Indeed, all around us, the cultural and relational nuances of communication pervade. My clients notice this most when making career moves because of the differences in teamwork, leadership style, and cultural fit at every company. Given this, new hires should make the time to learn about the people, the company culture, and how individuals interact with one another. New employees tend to pick up the paperwork and processes in their new jobs faster than establishing solid relationships with key stakeholders. Or they discover that it is nearly impossible to be effective at doing their jobs without relating well with the people. Thus, a smart 30, 60, 90-day onboarding plan will place appropriate emphasis on meeting and cultivating meaningful connections with the right people. Successful professionals understand that achieving high-level priorities and actionable goals is dependent on strong workplace relationships. Frames and perspectives. We've thus far established that communication is symbolic and requires meaning, and that messages and their meanings must be considered in the context of culture and relationships. Additionally, communication involves frames and perspectives. As communicators, we learn to interpret and understand communication in light of the given situation or context, the frame in which the communication occurs. Across the room from me is a painting my wife did last year. It's beautiful and has deep symbolic meaning to our family. It has a nice sturdy frame surrounding it. Both the framed canvas and wall it hangs on are painted, but when a dinner guest points to the wall and asks about the painting, I'm certain he or she is not referring to the white wall. I gather that the guest must only be referring to the artwork inside the frame. Now, imagine your life is that wall and holds framed paintings. The framed paintings represent relationships you have and groups you are part of. There may be similarities across the frames, but each is unique. Being attuned to communication frames helps people navigate interactions. For example, when I jog around my neighborhood and my neighbor stops me to ask, "Did you hear that last night?" I know for a fact he is not referring to the big news my sister called to tell me. Nor is he asking about my son who woke up crying in the middle of the night. I know that he is referring to the 5 seconds of bottle rockets that went off next door to me at around 9:30 p.m., when my very well-meaning neighbors were singing happy birthday in the driveway. I know this not because I can read his mind, but because it's the only logical frame of reference that this neighbor and I share. And because of that shared frame of reference, that is, being neighbors who happen to interact from time to time, I'm confident his perspective on the bottle rocket noise from the night before won't be positive, because he's mentioned previously that his pets are sensitive to loud sounds. This frame and perspective help me know how to navigate the conversation quickly so that I can politely exit and continue my run. Applied in the classroom, I constantly encourage my students to increase their effectiveness when talking with faculty by having them challenge their assumptions and reframe their perceptions. When a student considers the perspective of the faculty member and properly frames how to engage with him or her, that student may increase the likelihood of receiving the extension being asked for. Similarly, by intentionally considering the perspective of your manager and better framing the boundaries and assumptions of interacting with that manager, you may increase the likelihood of receiving extra time off, a desired project extension, the quarterly bonus, or more. Even if someone understands that communication is about messages and meanings within a cultural context, that person may fail to reframe and account for individual perspective. This is a guaranteed way to miss the mark as a communicator, and in some cases may even cause a person to lose a job. Imagine a manager and direct report who travel together for business. Over the course of travel on Monday, meals and drinks were shared and some personal stories were exchanged. They laughed together for the first time, established a stronger connection, and ended the evening feeling a bit closer. The next morning, they synced up downstairs in the hotel lobby and headed to the client site. On the ride over, feeling a bit closer to his boss from the day before, the associate jokingly admits being a tad bit hungover. Entering the client site, he gives a fist bump and tells his boss, "Let's do this." At lunch with the client later that day, when referring to his boss, he says, "Trust me, this guy has got some stories to tell." Fast forward a few days when they are back at headquarters and the boss calls his direct report in for a quick chat. He shares that next week they'll be traveling separately and he expects a higher level of professionalism from his protege going forward. This shows just how complex communication can be when it comes to relationships and how people frame their experiences and perspectives. These two did grow closer and friendlier during their travel day. But from the perspective of the manager, the subordinate was not supposed to carry their closeness and friendliness into the frame of workplace interaction. The key here is to understand that communication is about messages and meanings, which are better understood through cultural and relational context. And we should become adept at applying frames of reference and multiple perspectives when interacting with others and making sense of human interaction. Communication constants. These are but a few of the essentials to communication in everyday life that become even more, not less, valuable to us as society evolves and technology disrupts. This is partly because we are members of a global society who are constantly communicating across a variety of mediums. The exact example of the guy traveling with his boss may have just as easily happened 50 years ago before the onslaught of modern technology. But similar communication phenomena described in the story can happen just as easily today while messaging with your boss via smartphone one night and then joining for virtual calls together the next day. This highlights that as we stretch the boundaries of communication in some ways, a savvy communicator will remain grounded in the understanding of the essentials. Like a basketball player preventing traveling, you may spin or otherwise change position with one foot by leaning into a communication venture of your choosing, so long as your pivot foot does not move from its initial position or lose contact with the floor. In our case, that pivot foot must remain planted on the essentials of communication. Essential takeaways. At the end of each chapter, you'll find essential takeaways. These are the most important points you'll need to carry into your professional and personal lives to find lasting success. In this chapter, the essential takeaways are: while top-of-mind issues change, the foundations of communication don't. Communication is about messages and meaning, and humans communicate to convey meaning and accomplish goals. Communication is cultural and relational, and when we accommodate our own communication style to align with the cultural and relational norms of others, we may be signaling respect and even a desire to be part of that group. Chapter 2. Know why and how we communicate. Have you ever really thought about why you communicate? For a moment, forget other questions like when and how well you're communicating, and instead focus on the why. All of us have moments when we prefer to be alone, but can you fathom a life of solitude where you couldn't interact with others, either face-to-face or virtually? Think of the headlines during the pandemic about sadness, grief, and depression spiking as people tried to adjust to life in isolation and quarantine. Among many other lessons, the pandemic showed us just how much we crave interacting freely with others. Why? Because human communication touches many aspects of our lives, from our individual identity and daily needs to each and every experience with others. We are inherently social beings. It has long been argued we cannot not communicate. We instinctively turn to others for our socio-emotional health, and we suffer physically when denied the ability to interact with others. Communication helps us to accomplish our personal and professional tasks and goals. Considering even the simplest circumstances, like laundering clothes or getting takeout food, can you imagine accomplishing much of anything without some form of interaction, whether digitally, face-to-face, or a combination of both? Communication is how humans can achieve instrumental needs that may be big, for example, getting a job or earning a promotion, or small, for example, ordering a drink or getting called on during a meeting. Communication helps us maintain our physical and mental well-being and enables us to form and maintain our social and personal relationships. Aside from being born into a family or set up on playdates as a child, the quantity and quality of interactions we have with others is largely a product of if and how we communicate. As early as infants playing peekaboo with a parent and toddlers sharing toys on a playground, humans are refining their understanding of how connections with others are associated with the messages communicated verbally and nonverbally. Communication also helps us understand ourselves, including who we are and who we want to be, by enabling us to share our ideas and express our identities. As a case in point, consider how your attitude and attire may change in the span of any given day, or perhaps even within the hour. Within a month of living together, I could accurately identify the person my college roommate was talking to on the phone just by observing the way he carried himself and by paying attention to the sound of his voice. Many of us have predictable communication behaviors. What about you? What side of your identity do you show for a job interview? First date? What part of your identity do you perform when gathering with friends on a Friday night? Relatives over a holiday? Consider for a moment how you express these sides of yourself during various occasions, whether in how you dress, the ways you behave, or the things you choose to say or not to say. Actions, interactions, and transactions. Part of wrestling with why humans communicate requires properly considering the communication process. But even here, scholars have not always agreed. There are three basic models that show how our understanding of communication has evolved over time. The first, the action model, suggests that communication is a one-way process. In this view, one person says or does something that sends a message to the other or others. A text message sent that may be read. A voicemail left may be heard. An outfit worn in hopes of being noticed. These are all examples of communication as action. Going a step further is to see communications as an interaction, which implies communication is a two-way street and requires two or more individuals exchanging information. While leaving a voicemail or sending a message is an action, a phone call or rapid exchange of messages captures communication as an interaction. With time, scholars began to see these two models as quite limiting. Communication as an action, for example, serving a tennis ball, or interaction, for example, volleying a tennis ball back and forth, fails to explain how rich and dynamic communication can be. This led to the development of a third model, communication as a transaction, which seeks to explain how communicators are often sending and receiving messages simultaneously and constructing shared meanings or understandings together. Rather than seeing these models as good, better, and best, I encourage people to recognize that a given situation will naturally lend itself to be more adequately explained by a particular model. In order to better understand these different models of communication, let's use an example of a nurse conducting hospital rounds. If a patient says, "Nurse Davis checked my IV and then told me to push the button if I need something," it would suggest that the nurse treated their communication as an action. If that same patient says, "Nurse Johnson checked my IV, asked how I was feeling, offered me some water, and then reminded me to push the button if I needed anything," it may suggest that the nurse treated her communication with the patient as an interaction. And finally, if the patient reflects on the encounter and says, "Nurse Thompson checked my IV, we discussed my vitals and treatment plan, and then she reminded me to push the button if I need anything," it may suggest the nurse treated their communication as a transaction. The critical difference when it comes to understanding the distinction between an interaction and transaction is that an interaction can simply be exchanging messages without a relational component. Robots can interact. When we interact without a meaningful transaction occurring, we may say something like, "We talked about it, but I don't feel like I was heard or that we reached any sort of understanding." By contrast, when two or more participants create a shared meaning and understanding of information, rather than merely sending and receiving messages, this is a transactional model of communication. One challenge that even well-informed and well-meaning individuals face is knowing when and how to adopt a transactional model of communication. If a nurse must cover more beds than is reasonably manageable and feels rushed for time, can you really blame him or her for trying to make rounds quickly? Likewise, with so much work to do and information needing to be conveyed in any workplace, we are constantly forced to make decisions about how to communicate. Imagine you've been invited to interview for an exciting job. The recruiter schedules your interview, but it turns out that you aren't meeting with anyone. Instead, you have been given a block of time where you must use a device, connect to a portal, stare at a blank screen, and record your interview answers. There is zero human interaction, much less transaction. Instead, this is purely an act of regurgitating answers to a blank screen. A mistake people often make is to treat a live interview exactly the same as this one-way act of regurgitating answers to a screen. In the case of a live interview, you would be shortchanging yourself to see an interview as an interaction, where you are asked questions and then reply with answers. A great interviewee knows how to be a great conversationalist, who is not just answering questions, but simultaneously reading the interviewer and interacting with that person as if having coffee with a friend. This is the benefit of a transaction model, which helps to account for all the nuance and richness of human communication, and which the action and interaction models fail to appreciate. Choose how to communicate. Knowingly and unknowingly, we make many choices when we communicate. Should we speak online or face-to-face? Written or spoken? Dyadic, that is, between two people, in a group of people, as a public address, or by sending out a mass communication? Regardless of the communication event, essential elements of communication include a source or sender who encodes or creates a message that is sent through a chosen medium to be decoded or received by an audience or receiver. Members of the audience decode the meaning of the message based on their own attitudes and understandings, at which point they may respond to the message verbally or nonverbally. All of this may be subject to competing noise and interference. That is a quick rendition of the textbook explanation. To illustrate the point, let's look at a real-life example. Imagine that you, the sender, call, phone is your medium, your boyfriend, intended decoder or receiver. After a moment of exchanging the basics of how each other's day has gone, you blurt out, "I can't stand this any longer. I hate not being with you." Message delivered. It makes perfect sense to you to call and say this. After all, you've been dating each other exclusively for 6 great months, but have now spent the past week apart while your boyfriend visits his family out of state. The problem is that your boyfriend is watching a movie with his rambunctious nephews when he answers your call on speakerphone. As you speak your heartfelt words, you are competing with children's voices and a movie in the background. Noise. He and his nephews heard most of what you said but failed to catch a crucial word. They heard, decoded or received, "I can't stand this any longer. I hate being with you." He didn't hear the crucial word "not" and is now flushed with negative emotion. Confused and slightly embarrassed, he quickly hangs up on you. You glance at your messages to write to him and see what happened, but you notice 3 dots appear, disappear, and then appear and disappear again. Finally, 5 minutes later, you receive the message, "Are you kidding me right now? I'm done. We can talk tomorrow." With his phone turned off, you both spend the rest of the night in a state of despair. You are convinced that your bold move to call and express how you feel scared him and led to his whiplash toward breaking up, which you will talk about tomorrow. Meanwhile, he is furious that the person he has been falling in love with waited for him to leave town to call and dump him. Adding fuel to his fire, months ago you two agreed to always manage any conflicts or serious conversations in person because his last romantic partner ended the relationship via text message, a personal experience he found to be traumatizing. This scenario points to common mishaps in communication. In some form or another, they happen between lovers, siblings, colleagues, and roommates. In this case, the obvious miscommunication culprits include the medium. A phone conversation is less media-rich than a video call or face-to-face interaction. And the noise. The boyfriend was distracted by his nephews and the movie they were watching. But there are other factors worth considering, such as the way the message was crafted and delivered. We know it's possible to convey our message effectively when communicating by phone and competing against noise. In this case, you, the speaker, could have created a clearer message or waited for a quieter moment. Your boyfriend also could have secured a quieter environment for taking the call or asked a clarifying question before assuming the worst and ending the call. We also have to consider the fact that the boyfriend's previous life experiences attuned and heightened his sensitivities to breakup language by phone. Whatever the explanation, just like many communication hiccups, a shared meaning between you two was not achieved. And this shows just how complex communication really is. Shared meaning is the mutual understanding of a message between sender and receiver. Co-creating a shared meaning is often the goal, and when not achieved, regardless of whether the outcome is positive or negative, a communication failure has transpired. And the impacts can range from inconsequential to lethal. A misunderstood joke between two employees may be shrugged off and forgotten within seconds, or it may lead to a lawsuit. A poorly timed wink and smile from a judge may go unnoticed, or it may inadvertently signal jurors to tilt the scales of justice. Communicators striving for shared meaning see communication as more than a linear act, like an archer aiming for the bullseye, or a back-and-forth exchange, like a game of table tennis. Those seeking shared meaning instead recognize the complex nature of communication, think about context more broadly, and believe that all participants in an interaction are senders and receivers simultaneously. Everyone is part of the messages and meaning-making, including the close talker, low talker, no talker, rambler, eye roller, arm crosser, foot stomper, doodler, eyebrow raiser, throat clearer, gum smacker, and you. During a presentation, I often look to the audience and ask, "Who is doing the majority of communication right now?" It's a rhetorical question, but still, many are inclined to point at me, which is reasonable to think given that I am the presenter. I proceed by pointing at myself and the crowd simultaneously to make the case that, while I may be sending most of the verbal messages during the presentation, everyone in the room is communicating. Together, we are sending and receiving messages to accomplish goals and convey meaning. Those in the audience may be listening to my words and focusing on my nonverbal cues, but I too am absorbing each of the nonverbal cues that I can catch from them. The messages from the audience are a continuous feedback loop informing and compelling me as I nimbly adapt. In the case of the couple's phone call mentioned earlier, we know that the medium was not media-rich, a phone call with distracting noise. And that it's possible the interactants were acting but not transacting, which would explain why the message sent was not the message received, and shared meaning was not created. To the degree we understand this essential communication concept, we can better operationalize our knowledge, skills, and abilities for improving ourselves as communicators. essential takeaways. Human communication touches many aspects of our lives, from our individual identity and daily needs to each and every experience with others. Communication helps us to accomplish our personal and professional tasks and goals. Communication can be an action, namely a one-way process, an interaction, for example, a two-way street, or a transaction where communicators construct shared meaning together. Communicators striving for shared meaning see communication as more than a linear act, like an archer aiming for the bullseye, or a back-and-forth exchange, like a game of table tennis. Chapter 3. Discover the I in Communicate. Picture yourself as a water jug. Life experiences and messages fill your jug like water. Your individuality and uniqueness flavors what's in there like a Kool-Aid pouch. Along the way and throughout your life, a lot of messages pour out of your jug. In working with students and clients over the years, this has been my most helpful way to explain why people communicate so differently. Part of our uniqueness is attributable to the distinct flavor of our Kool-Aid, but then there is also a lot to be said for all those messages and experiences that fill our jug. Find the root causes of how you communicate. An important reason for pausing on this is because individuals seeking to increase their effectiveness as communicators typically want to jump immediately into evaluating and modifying their communication behaviors without actually exploring the root causes of those behaviors. The reality is that there is a strong relationship between how people communicate with us, how we see ourselves, and how we then communicate with others. Thus, making outward gains in your communication effectiveness requires doing some inner work. Let me explain further. In most cases, when I have a client who wants help on a big interview for a job, the easiest part of our work together tends to be crafting strong content, while the most challenging part tends to be coaching the client to deliver it well. Why is that the case? Because there's so much to consider when it comes to how each of us experiences the world around us when developing and delivering messages. When coaching, I juggle with questions like, what if my client tends to shut down when sitting across the table from an old white guy? What if my client is triggered every time someone mentions his or her accent? Beyond developing content and rehearsing delivery, imagine the number of outside factors that influence your communication effectiveness. For these reasons, being an exceptional communicator isn't merely learning when to pause, it's also knowing what gives you pause. Our water jugs are filled by everyday interactions and experiences. But then there are memorable messages that, like it or not, seem to stick with us. For instance, growing up, you may have interacted with your primary caregiver nearly every day and perhaps multiple times a day. Certain things your primary caregiver said may echo with you forever, yet not all your interactions are particularly memorable. I don't recall every meal I had with my family as a child, but a handful of things said during certain mealtime conversations left a strong impression on me. On the other hand, I can think of people I dined with only once, yet they said something that stuck with me for years. The point being, regardless of the person or the nature of your relationship, a memorable message is one that you remember for long periods of time and may potentially influence the course of your life in some meaningful way. I will never forget when, as a freshman in high school, the principal interrupted my classroom and asked to speak with me in the hall. I was shocked.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.